This is the most difficult time I've ever had with this. Because last time, this is a class that's been running several years. Only I took about a year's break, or almost a year and a half. And so I'm hopping in the middle. And since last time everybody was new, I started a great big grand review of everything that had come heretofore, and the grand review was going to be in three parts: last meeting, this meeting, and the next meeting. However, this time everybody is new again, and well, Ron is old and Dale is old, and he doesn't want to hear that, but no, these three people were not here.
Oh,
you asked for the. Oh, you were here for the cosmology class last time. My goodness, it's very rare that a woman sits through these classes that I don't take great notice of her. Okay. What we did last time was we began from an absolute beginning, which is unfathomable by our consciousness, even though Ron would like me to be able to say the ultimate meaning of it all. I don't think at this point that I'm capable of it, but I don't want to negate myself by saying that I'm not. And we looked at the beginning of creation in the sense of pure logic, and we talked about the relationship of the Supreme Being to the unspeakable, the absolute. We talked about that in terms of a logic that was parallel with mathematical thinking. We talked about time and space and spirit and matter filling time and space. And we talked about reflections of being in the unknown, producing various states of existence that we call realms or worlds or planes of existence. And we talked about them as each having a principle. And we talked about them each having a life and a character of its own. And there we stopped. We said that we talked about cosmic planes that are beyond, way, way beyond our current consciousness, until we got to the lowest of these cosmic planes, where a being that we call God has its consciousness. And that is the source, purpose, and direction of our evolution. We also set down a basic taken from several different kinds of mystery teachings about cosmology, a basic formula for the beginning of a cosmos. And that is where we left off. We talked about, we're about to talk about now, how time and space and change of consciousness take place in the creative work, which is both a creation and an evolution. And we began talking a little bit about worlds. So that means we have to start with Paracelsus. Paracelsus was a great healer and an alchemist who traveled the whole world over giving his services and gaining as much wisdom as he could. It is even rumored that he went as far as Tibet in his search for wisdom about healing. And the story was that during some of the plagues of his time, he would do healing work all day, 12 hours or so, and then come home and study when most people would be dropping. And there are all sorts of stories. He's one of the people that, you know, that the story goes about that when people didn't have proper nutrition for their children, he gave them a cow and such like that. But beside all those benign sides, he was a rather rigorous alchemist. And he studied magic very deeply. And he has one of the best backgrounds into astrology of anyone. Actually, the way astrology works. But we're going to talk a little bit tonight, just as a reintroduction, to his alchemy book. In his basic alchemy book, he said, in the study of alchemy, there are seven metals. Gold, silver, mercury, copper, tin, iron, lead. And one of the reputed chores of the alchemists was to turn base metals into gold. And it was there were all sorts of astrological formulae about this. And the gold was associated with the sun, and the silver was associated with the moon, and mercury was associated with Mercury. Only you have to guess which one I said first. And Venus was associated with copper. Jupiter was associated with tin. Mars was associated with iron, and Saturn was associated with lead. If you take a modern book on spiritual studies and look at the cosmography, that is the layout of the worlds, they are found in a similar way. This is what is called the world of God. This is a virgin spirit. This is divine spirit. This is life spirit. This is mind. This is desire. And this is physical. If you remember from last time, we said that the spirit in time has life and character, and it projects its energies into form, and it congeals matter out of space as a crystallization of its ignorance with regard to its knowledge. And it enlivens by interacting with matter, or with the potentiality of becoming. By interacting with it, it takes matter and it refines it. And matter becomes spiritualized as spirit becomes materialized. And so basically the alchemist's work was the changing of base metals, or usually lead, beginning with lead, into gold, which meant taking the stuff of our regular experience, and by interacting with the stuff of our experience, coming to know ourself and to bring spiritual consciousness and light as a potential out of matter that was originally ignorant. And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about the whole plan of evolution. And I just went into this chart for one reason, and that is to reintroduce the field of evolution. For most people, this is it. They think that this is all there is and nothing to it. By the way, two of these realms have major divisions in them. The physical has a division, well, they actually all have at least seven, but there, some of them have minor subdivisions. This is the chemical. Which is the solids, liquids, and gases. And this is the etheric, which has to do with various states of vitality, life, and energy. So what we're saying is that behind this physical world, there is something that gives birth to life, and that energizes and moves and changes everything in existence. Even the movement of planets and other physical bodies through space is accomplished through an etheric realm. And the purpose of this etheric realm is just that, to effect changes. And behind all of our movements, and behind all of our life, is a motive. That is a feeling or an emotion that has some intent that causes things to change. There is a desire, there is a feeling. Pammy does a lot of dancing. She knows what it's like to have such a feeling that it has to be expressed. And you can have all of the energy in the world, but if there is no motive, desire to move or change or do anything, you're not going to dance. And then behind that are thoughts and ideas, thoughts being associated with concrete thinking, and ideas associated with ideational thinking. These are complete thoughts. We know why or how, probably even better how, what and how, when we form a complete thought. But behind that is a why. A higher purpose, a principle, a universal idea, the idea of goodness, or the, you know, there are all sorts of different ideas that we put together. We usually apprehend them more in poetry than any other place, though the formulae that exist in the sciences are also ideas. And of course, probably one of the grandest and most complex ideas is the astrological mandala. And behind that is a realm where there is light and truth and life in a higher sense. When one says that's life, they're talking about, they're not talking about this kind of life that is associated with vitality and squirminess. They're talking about an eternal, constant, purposeful existence. When we have an idea, the lights go on. Not this kind of light, but an inner light. And the light that permeates that is the intuitive light of truth. And that is what is found in a realm called a realm of life spirit. Like in some philosophies, it's called the buddhic plane and such like that. Yeah.
What did you say, vitality?
Energy.
Squirminess.
Squirminess, yeah. Things that live, you know, like...
All right. No, is that plane there, is that readable by people? Or is it, you know, like...
Yes.
Like Steiner or Brangle or those guys?
Mozart.
The ideational?
Yes.
Okay, or maybe by some artistic ideas?
I think... Any
You don't see too much of, I'm not sure we see too much of it around, you know, in paintings and that, but I just have a feeling that
no,
there.
Because I think it's...
it could be there.
Well...
And I'm just, I don't know if I'm going to, I just wanted to bounce that off you.
Yeah. There is one idea that is more, one brace of ideas that is more important than any other brace of ideas. One is the idea of self, which is probably universal. And that idea of self, when reflected back into the divine, was called by the Neoplatonists Immaculate Conception. They pictured a tetrahedron. That was their symbol for it. Let me finish.
Okay.
Personality is when we have an experience of a separate personal existence, and we observe that and we come to the conclusion that we are separate and we are different. That is a personal thought. It's a statement of personal existence. But the threefold spirit, that is the will of the divine spirit, if this is out of what you're experiencing, just don't worry about it. We'll get back to it. Pretty soon you'll be all familiar with this kind of thinking. The divine masculine and the divine feminine exist co-equally and cotaneously. That will and imagination exist side by side. And out of them is born an idea of self. But it isn't until that idea is formed as a complete idea that the character of the divine, when the divine sees itself as a universal idea, that is called the birth of individuality or the birth of self, and that is considered an immaculate conception. As opposed to a being born in the physical body, which is a conception that has to do with physical coition. It's much more, there are deeper things to it than that. And so the two ideas that are the most central ideas are the idea of self and the idea of self as God. Okay. And then the life spirit then is the light of intelligence, it is the selfness out of which selfhood is born. And then the divine spirit is, it wills. Now this proper is more our field of evolution, what we've spoken of here. These five worlds, or with the subdivisions, these seven realms. What I'm trying to get to is a conception of virginity. It's a really hard conception, and this is pondering on my part because in no teaching anywhere have I ever run into it. The idea, virgin spirit, is one term that is used for it because it means spirit that is untouched by evolution. Some schools are more materialistic and they don't relate to it in terms of spirit. They relate to it in terms of position of consciousness, and it's called the realm of monads, which is a focus emphasis rather than a spiritual emphasis. But this is the way it's described relative to what we're talking about. That is the birth of a cosmos. And that is, it says that in the spirit of God, some of the spirit, which is capable of individual focus, is all conscious, but not objectively all conscious, not self-consciously all conscious, and not aware of either subjectivity or objectivity. Now, so it's like the all consciousness of the divine has this in it. Now, I'm going to try and give you an idea that I've been pondering on for quite a while to understand it. I can give you a metaphor or an image, and these light bulbs do a pretty good job of it. If you look at a light bulb in the dark, first there is the body of the bulb itself, and then there is a haze of light that is outside of it. And I think the spirit has potential in the same way that space and matter has potential. And I think we even as spirit in ourselves can sense something, and our awakened consciousness irradiates and penetrates into it, even though we haven't fully wakingly understood it and lived it all the way through. And it's like saying to ourselves, I want to explore part of my divine being that is, but still it really isn't, because I've never explored it yet. And so it has the luster of the light of the divine spirit, but not the actual light itself, like within the light bulb. As that is a way I understand it. Any objections? Or?
No.
Okay. All right. And
now, Paracelsus put things in little jugs and bubble and boil them and stuff. And I was just wondering how you relate this stuff to all that.
Yes. I could relate this stuff to all of that, but I'm not likely to, but I will in later classes if you like. Because the consummation of changing base metals into gold is something that must actually be done. And alchemists actually do alchemical work. It isn't only symbolical of the spiritual work that they're doing, but it is an objective experiment to prove that they can do what they do.
Just a quickie here. See, I've never met somebody with an actual philosopher's stone. They're kind of hard to meet, those kinds. But you've met people who talked about different...
I've met people that have claimed to have done it.
I've met people who said they knew someone who saw one, you know. But the point is, here's, I don't know, that's off the track. The point is here, in Paris, just one short point, in Paracelsus, who's, I find fairly demanding to read, he'll mention all kinds of stuff, on and on and on, and then he'll put in one sentence here and there about, like, talking to spirits or reading the etheric realm or looking through a crystal, and you don't, you know, that sort of just flashes out at me that he was... There's a sneaking idea in there that he was pulling in forces there that he just kind of lets you know here and there. And
yeah.
Doesn't describe
yeah.
It. And that's, you could, that is totally different. You probably had to have the right little matrix going on with his jugs and his doing stuff. But he was pulling in forces to make it work. In fact, there were probably a whole number of ways you could have made that stuff work. But anyway, that's my idea. Now,
mm-hmm.
You're kind of, your chart there kind of looks like that, but you didn't say it.
Okay.
Is that a reasonable idea?
Yes.
That's never written down in any book, though. Well, no, some people say, well, maybe you have to have some sort of spiritual connection, but just when they stop, you don't see what that is.
Yeah, but I think that all of the, I think that there is, in each plane, there is an objectivity. The ignorance of the form side, the ignorance of matter, which gives us resistance, also gives us objectivity. If you have something, the more ignorant something is, the more it demands that you know what you know in order to be able to work with it. That if, probably the best example that you have from your experience is working with a computer. A computer is as ignorant as something comes, and if you don't tell it every step what to do, it won't do it. And so you have to be in control of that device every step of the way. And I'm saying that alchemical experiments of all kinds are objectifications that you know what you're doing and you prove it to yourself and to the cosmos by doing it. But it isn't just an insecure kind of proving, it is an artistic work, especially when you're talking about being able to give life to matter and bring it to various states of evolutionary consciousness. That's not a a mediocre kind of experiment.
Right.
Okay. So, we're talking about virgin spirit. We're talking about a consciousness that is potentially divine. And it's aware of the divine, but it's not aware of the character of the divine in itself, either as an individuated spirit or as God, if you wish to choose that word. So this is what we're talking about. We're talking about us and other beings in evolution that have participated in this creative work. And we're talking about the potential of becoming divine by a participation in the alchemical work of evolution. And so our basic essence is as a virgin spirit. And that virgin spirit remains virgin in some ways. It watches and it experiences the whole creation without actually itself being of the creation. I don't know how to say it, of the stuff of creation. But in the process of watching it through, it awakens its divinity and indeed becomes God. So what we're talking about is something very holy. We're talking about our basic divine origin, and we're saying that we didn't become divine somewhere along the way, and our future isn't any more of divinity than our past was. We're saying that our basic nature is spirit, has always been spirit, and will always be spirit. It'll just have different potentials. All right. This is the kind of thing Ron's not too excited about. It. Just teasing. Okay.
Oh, are you done with Paracelsus? Just a question. Did he really achieve the philosopher's stone, or was he just...
I don't know.
Off when he was 35 or something like that, like they say.
I don't know. I know he was rather outspoken in a way that would form deadly enemies. Yes?
In terms of what you've just said, can you relate consciousness to that?
That's something of what we spoke of last time. We spoke of consciousness. We went even deeper into the realms of the spirit. and we went into the absolute. And we said that the one characteristic that we both could and couldn't speak about in the absolute, which is unspeakable, is consciousness. We couldn't even talk about being because the absolute is both being and non-being. And that the one thing that seems to permeate everything in all existence is consciousness. Even unconsciousness or subconsciousness or threshold consciousness. And those are all just about it, if you can even use it. You might say what we're talking about here is if we have space and time, and filling time we have spirit and matter, and this is a pole that things are either more material and less wakingly spiritual or more wakingly spiritual and less material, that is a field in which consciousness plays. I have a friend who has a very good simile for it. It's like looking at light passing through dust. You never really see the light. All you see is the light reflected. And the spirit matter pole is like the dust. It's more dense, or it is more rare. It is more active, or it is more passive and receptive. But all of that is within the light. Only I think the relationship to the absolute is that it even transcends light. In some ways that it's very dangerous to contemplate too much because it usually leads to a megalomaniac type of madness. But in some ways, darkness is more holy than light. And the consciousness that pervades it all and doesn't at the same time is more holy. It's something that it can apprehend itself, but when it's self-apprehended, it isn't enough. When you know yourself, even in spirit, and you know the divine in spirit, that isn't enough. You keep looking for something more, and it always is more antecedent. And that is what always leads us on, and that is the consciousness itself. All right.
You're talking about light, physical light, is about the only thing that we know that is independent of its source, pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. More so than sound appears to be in the physical world.
Yeah, like the velocity. Yeah,
and that's why seeing and hearing are the dispersional senses.
Matter space, that kind of reminded me of relativity, where that was stuck together in a vector, and space, time, pole.
Yeah, I put it on a pole, which is a rather unfair way to do it.
Well, I don't know. Relativity doesn't totally satisfy me anyway, but you know what I mean? They have that same.
Okay. So, the oneness of the divine is present all throughout evolution. Even before the worlds are even congealed, it's there and it remains there all along. And the same is true of the purposes of the divine. That is, the creation is for real. We want our creations to live, and that much more so does God, the universal spirit, want its creation to live. It's playing for keeps. I don't know how to say it any other way. And even though what the spirit is trying to attain to can never be attained. The going all out and completely giving of self to it does something that in that kind of self-giving, when it is completely total, it in fact does bring an objective life to the creation, and it does live, and the unity is extended within itself. And so the creation at all times is going on. It isn't as, like, for example, the deists feel that the creation was made and that the divine just sits there and watches it. It's not that the creation is all made in the beginning or in the process, but at every step of the way, every being that is involved in the creation is more or less creating. We as individual foci of the one center are meant to be every bit as much creative as the heart of it all. So the whole process then involves a creative activity. And so the creation is always present, and the perfect working for the creation is feedback. So there is cause and consequence present at all times. It's sort of like when the divine gives itself and gives itself completely, it has to be fed back because it is itself. And those two principles, the principle of continuous creation, which is found in the principle of analogy because it's always recreated at every time that the analogy comes alive. It's called as above, so below. It's the Hermetic axiom. And the principle of cause and consequence as it works both vertically and horizontally. That is to say, everything that goes down must also come up, and everything that goes out must also come back in. And so these produce the three qualities of evolution. It's called involution, wherein spirit congeals itself into matter and becomes more involved into matter, and evolution, whereby spirit passes through matter and comes back into itself in a spiritual state, bringing the matter with it, and what takes place at every step of the way is epigenesis. Even in our ignorance, there is epigenesis. Even in our ignorance, we can cut a form by our resistance. And it's an unconscious creativity, but it is an epigenesis. And it is a service at every step along the way. Even our ignorance is a service. Okay. Now we're getting a little closer to the principles we want to get to. This is working rather nicely. It's going nice and slow. Okay, we'll have to reintroduce something that we were talking about last time. We said that within the creative work, there are three different kinds of states of existence. That which relates to time, which is called a period. I don't know how you would say it different. At different times, it's been called aeons. Or you could say eternities. Well, that word is not a good one anymore. You can't say epochs because that has a very specific meaning. But in the ancient languages, each of these states had a name to it. So we're talking about time wherein the spiritual consciousness is developed. And in terms of space, there are worlds and the organization of worlds into something that in the Western terms is called globes. You might say a state of space or a state of a world is called a globe. It's an organization of the material consciousness. And finally, you have the change, and the change is what produces the differentiation of consciousness by involving and evolving in and out of different states of matter in different states of time. There are changes of consciousness, and from that is born an objective kind of consciousness. And the change is usually talked about in terms of revolutions. Only we shouldn't use this word too much, or people are going to be suspicious of us, and they're going to think that this is some kind of fifth column or something like this here. See, now see, it's all blue just as a cover-up, because it's really red underneath when he's talking about spiritual revolutions. Yeah. Yes.
I'd like to make a comment that I have personally found dance to be a very sort of compact way of exploring these three.
Yes.
Topics.
Yes. In fact, that brings up something that was very unsatisfied, because Ron and I have these conversations, and it's like sparks fly every direction. We don't get a chance to follow them all. In fact, there is, for each of these realms, there is an art. The art for the chemical world is architecture, and the art for the etheric world is sculpture. It shows how life works into form. And the art for the desire world, since all desire appears as color, is painting. And the art for the world of concrete thought is music, because it is pitch. Does that ring true? And the art for the ideational realm is poetry, but especially drama, because there is where character is created, a self or a personification of an idea of character. And finally, for the incessant life, which has a flowing purpose all of its own that cannot too much be objectified, is dance. For the realm of life spirit, I've never heard of an art for the realm of divine spirit, but it's probably the art of silence or something like that. Whereas it seems it does all things by seeming to sit there doing nothing. Okay. Oh. And so we left off last time. We said that the chief attribute of spirit with a capital S and of everything in creation is character. Such as when we say that person is a character, or that moral deed had a lot of character. But the manifest quality is character. All right. Now we get to the topic we were trying to get to. This is a very, very swift recapitulation. The character of the creation, even antecedent to what we're talking about in the divine cosmic planes, the character is indicated by true astrology. Not the astrology of horoscopy. The astrology of horoscopy is an external overlay. Because we are foreign from the world of spirit, and we have exiled ourselves into this cell, you might say, without life and light in it, or at least not very much, we need something to maintain a contact with the spiritual worlds. And so even our contact, our lens, has to be something tangible. And that tangible thing that we use to correspond with the inner worlds is a symbol. And the astrology that when you're looking at rising signs and horoscopes with squares and sextiles and such, you're looking at a symbolic framework that represents something that is behind it that is multidimensional. In fact, we're going to make all kinds of symbols tonight that represent things that are multidimensional. But the astrology that we're speaking of now, this is creative astrology. This means to say that the character of the divine is septenary, and that these seven principles of character are interplay with each other, and they interplay with each other in such a way that the divine can manifest itself with complete and perfect balance and cover all. Now, we have to remember the analogy. These planets are put together in a different sequence. In terms of cosmology, this is in terms of cosmography. This is the way the planets stand in terms of cosmography. And very often, even all of the subplanes in cosmography carry this same kind of quality to them, same order, though it doesn't seem vary from time to time on planes. You know what I'm talking about? I'm saying that, for example, if we take the desire world, where selfishness pushes people away and it destroys desire forms. And so when we have desires that are so selfish that they're destructive, there's a principle where the attractive force that works in desire is overwhelmed by the repulsive force. And it's sort of like going to the movies when the bad guys steal all of this, the outlaws steal all of this gold from the bank, and in order to be immune from being captured by the lawmen, they head for the Badlands. And pretty soon they each think, well, four people is too many people to divide this gold over, so pretty soon somebody murks somebody else off. And it's the principle that there is no honor among thieves and dissension rules. That is the lowest. See, well, I'm having to recapitulate all sorts of things from past years. This goes back about 3 or 4 years ago when I was talking about this. The lowest realm of that is Saturnine, whereas the highest realm in the realm of desire is where one gives out with the full power of the soul, just gives and gives out all lovingly. It's sometimes called the philanthropic realm. And that is sort of like Saturn. And what I'm saying is to understand it literally, if you're reading with clairvoyance into these different realms, you have to be able to attune yourself. You yourself are the instrument. And you have to be able to play yourself like an instrument. And without falling prey, you have to understand that you have all of these things in you, but not in such a way that you cling or that you stick to these realms. And that clairvoyance is a matter of pitching yourself to a given plane, and then the things that are in that plane open themselves to you. And each one of them is a world like this world. It's peopled with all kinds of beings and all kinds of living things, not all of which have focused virgin spirits in them. Some of them are just elemental forms that are made up of the life of desires. You know, you can build a little thing out there and set it running if you want.
In all seriousness, no, I'm not joking with you, because I think you can pull in some intuitions on this. This space alien thing, I'm not joking. I mean, people, I have this notion that I've expressed to other people, that you were in tune with your higher God self, you could deal with them in a respectful way, you know, like they mm-hmm. don't just sort of minx you, like come up and just, you know, they seem to have these semi powers, so they seem to be able to turn on my chakras, just like no people in there, they just don't know how to do it. But people have, here's the end of this, people have said, no, you know, they're beyond all of this. They say, well, how can anything be beyond God?
Yeah, that's true. Which I agree wholeheartedly.
So let me, you got a good chart up there now. So where do they come in? Are they spin off somewhere like right below mine, maybe? They don't know fiddly about desires. They know a lot about mind. Desires, they have no morality, most of them. Some of them do. Some of them do. But the bad ones don't. You know, they don't even know they're bad.
I'm not going to speak to that. I'm not going to address that issue at this moment.
Okay. Just got it on the chart there.
Okay.
They must be on that chart, don't you think?
They're within it, yes.
Somewhere, yeah.
Yes.
They can't be outside God.
That's correct. Okay. And so these get reconfigured in another way. And that's what we're going to be reviewing now very quickly. And this order is Saturn, Sun, Moon, Earth, which is broken into Mars and Mercury, Jupiter, Venus, and a state that we'll call Vulcan. This is a sequence. This is a cosmographical sequence, meaning a static sequence. This is a sequence that is cosmological. You recognize this one because this is probably, you've been most familiar with this more than any other. This is Saturday. This is Sunday. This is Monday. This is Tires Tog Tuesday, this is Wednesday, this is Thursday or Thor's Tog, and this is Friday, and this is rest, which means something very big, which we're going to recapitulate in about 10 sentences tonight because we won't have time to it. All right. So what we're talking about is we're saying that there are seven periods of time. And these periods of time each has the character of Saturn, Sun, Moon, Earth, Jupiter, Venus, and Vulcan. And within each of these periods, there are seven states of matter. And these states of matter are called globes. And they have the same names, Saturn, Sun, Moon, Earth, etc. And there are seven revolutions of consciousness. But there is a reflective symmetry. That is to say that what goes out comes back in. What goes down comes back up. And as a consequence, in order to have seven states of existence, these are the way they're drawn. This is one of those terrible symbols that you have to deal with. These are globes, but if these are realms, the seven globes are manifest within four realms at a time. All right. So what happened at the beginning of the creation? We gave this formula last time about a section of space is permeated by the intelligence of the divine, and the divine ponders on it. And in all cases of pondering or turning inward, there is an outward radiation that occurs when you turn inward, and there is a revolution of consciousness. And that is what took place in the cosmos. This projection of the divine into itself relative to a place of space, which I can't think of as extensional space like that stuff out there, though that had something to do with it, but it's like an inner space, that this consciousness of the divine puts itself into space. And built within the divine are these cosmological principles, so that the revolution of consciousness pours itself into the form of thought, and then it comes back out, and it goes in again, and it comes back out. You know what I'm trying to say? That it's like... See, all of these talks, the past several years of talks, have all been leading up to another year of talks that I want to do here somewhere, talking completely about forms of meditation and how forms of meditation should be in order to be successful based on the principles of the cosmos. And if they're based on the principles of the cosmos, then you're intelligently aligning yourself with the laws of creation, and you're fulfilling the purpose of evolution, and you're just not doing some willful self-exercise. Okay, so this first period of time is all called Saturn. And normally what I do is just to give you a few keywords of Saturn from astrology, because there is a relevance in that way. Darkness, separation, resistance, sacrifice, seeds, minerals, coldness, foundation, ignorance, selfishness, sensation, form, hate, conscience, depth, contraction, faithfulness.
Do we have a few more positive ones? Were those mostly negative?
No, they're all very good. That is to say that the quality of the whole Saturn period was one of darkness. And we, as Virgin Spirit, suddenly found ourselves focused into a separate kind of existence. And it's described, the word that is used is immersion. And it's sort of like if you've ever been around the blacksmith shop where there is hot red or white iron and you immerse it into cold water. And what happens is that a focus, a seed you might say, of each and every one of us became a focus in this dark period, because the meditation is still just beginning. It's all dark. And we see from our we can see from our chart, if this is the field of activity, this is divine spirit. And if we ever have an enlightenment in the realm of the Christ, this is life spirit. This is ideational thought, and this is concrete thought. So in the beginning of the cosmos, we were no more in our first existence a seed and a seed of thought. Everything begins in thought. And we were plunged into this. Only the act of giving up that all consciousness voluntarily, which is kind of difficult to do before you have a self, which is a really tricky issue that I don't want to get into at all, because the metaphysical implications of it are so deep and so difficult that we couldn't do it any justice at all, which means I don't want to look into it right away. Anytime there is a sacrifice like that, the resistance produces warmth. So this is described, now mind you, this is described in spiritual realms no deeper than thought, a cosmos that existed in warm thought of separation, and that all of space that was not manifest seemed cold, and we each seemed to congeal into like little focal points, little seeds of consciousness. And that sacrifice that warmed up the space was like a love. It's like a resistance. Like when you give yourself to something, in a spiritual kind of physics, friction that produces warmth is a sacrifice. It's like a burning up of something. And so there were these seven globes that we revolved around seven times, and the first revolution was called the Saturn Revolution, and the Saturn globe and such like that. This gets very detailed, and I don't want to spend a whole bunch of time in it. And in that, we were mineral-like. We began as minerals. And our service to the cosmos was the same as the minerals right now. We provided forms. And we were like snowballs, you might say. We were made into things, and we were made into things by tones. Obviously, we were not alone in this. There were many other beings, which we're going to talk a little bit about, very, very briefly, because this is a really short run-through. And in this state of existence, we were still ignorant, and associated with the ignorance of this new matter, so we provided resistance in the same way that the minerals in our body provide resistance. But on the other hand, if we didn't have resistance, if the minerals didn't provide that resistance, our skeletons would just fall apart. So even the ignorance and the undeveloped part of us is part of the service at the same time that the positive is of us. Okay, and that was our activity. We were formed, and we were formed many times, and we went through all of these revolutions until the last revolution, which is called the Vulcan Revolution. And then something else happened. As a consequence of feeling both formability and resistance at the same time, the experience of resistance and the unchangeability that allowed change to take place, that experience awakened in us a spiritual potential. And that put spiritual potential to resistance, awakened something the experience always gives us much more, it seems, than was put into it. And that is the spiritual capability, which is called the divine spirit, which is known as the source of will. So it's like saying will was developed in relation to resistance. And so going through this whole period, which took many millions of years, this stuff wasn't even here yet. It hadn't even been congealed in the meditation of the divine. all that was there, it got to be as deep as thought. And so all we developed in there was a physical body, or the seed of a physical body that was made out of thought, and the potentiality of a divine spirit from the realm of divine spirit. So we were sort of like a mineral at that. We were at a mineral-like state. All right. I'll introduce one more thing, and that is there were various spiritual beings that worked on us. In fact, there were some that worked on the cosmos. And there were some beings that were associated. Last time we talked, remember we talked about all of the zero and one producing two and the reflections? The potentiality of making a differentiation between self that is known and self that is unknown. There were actually beings. It wasn't just a mathematical activity we were talking about. There were actually beings that are very, very great creative beings that produced that potential for a divided existence at all. And they were called the Xenophim, which made possible the idea of space and time, and the Teraphim, which made possible, the idea of time and spirit, and the Teraphim, which made possible the notion of space and matter. They preconditioned the cosmos.
I'm forgetting, is this step on the Rosicrucian
cosmos? No.
Oh, no wonder I didn't remember it. I don't know if I've ever heard of Xenophim and Teraphim.
Oh,
where did you get that idea?
Oh, you find them. This isn't only Rosicrucianism. This is from a lot of different sources. You can find Xenophim or Xenophim. And if you like...
You write that down, that's a strange word. No, you're talking about notions of space.
Yeah, the preparation for the possibility of space and of matter was produced by the... No, they're not around anymore. But they skedaddled, man. And though some people take the N out of here. That's if you look in the unabridged. If you look in the unabridged Oxford Dictionary, the conception of Xenophim or Xenophim, and in terms of divinity, is Xeno means foreigners, and Zeo means original source. So I don't know which is which. I don't know which is applicable. But I didn't want to get into all these details. I got all the tapes yet from the run through a couple of years ago. We were just doing the review now, you know.
I wasn't there.
Yeah, I'll sell you the tapes.
Oh, all right. Good.
Okay. And there was one more group that is called the Lords of the Flame. And the Lords of the Flame emanated from themselves the potentiality of having a physical body and the potentiality of having a divine spirit. And I don't know how to say it. In fact, this is probably the most important conception we're going to talk about all night. You cannot do anything with spiritual development except that you live it. And if you give yourself to something, is the only way that you can live it. And everything that we are now, our willpower, our ability to imaginatively conceive life and purpose, our ability to have ideas, thoughts, feelings, actions, and even experience physical form has been given to us by the gods. And they didn't just give it to us, they gave us the potential of ourselves by giving themselves to us. Like when there is the conception of Christ laying down his life for his followers and giving his life for his followers, that is a beautiful and a sublime conception. But this is something that goes even deeper into creation than that. Our very existence and the potentiality of our existence was given into us even before we were. In fact, now we've got to evict them.
One more line on it.
The gods. Yes, we give it back by creating, but we also give it back by evicting. Until everything that was projected into us as a principle or as a law or as a state or condition of being by the gods, when it has taken and we have found ourselves in our divine sense, we throw it out. And part of the throwing out is a giving back. Part of it is a creative giving on our own, and we then become laws in ourselves. The beautiful thing about it is that we become laws in ourselves with complete harmony, because the essential essence of the unity that was from the beginning is never lost. You can't create without love. And behind all of those things, like the devil can't procreate, you know, the Rosemary's Baby and all of that, behind all of those notions are very profoundly deep principles. And that's what, you know, that's the activity that we're involved with. Okay. There's always been a notion, there are various notions about the devil, so to speak. The devil doesn't cast a shadow, for example, which means to say that the devil is an etheric being. And no matter how solid it may be, the light is still passing right through because it isn't made of this stuff. And another conception is that the devil, I'm speaking in parentheses and somewhat, not mockingly, but lightly disapproving of the cosmic notion or of the folk notion of a devil. But it's said that the devil, because the devil hates instead of loving, the devil cannot procreate. And therefore the devil has to procreate through the selfish deeds of others, and so it influences others to selfish deeds. That's folklore, and that's what the notion is with Rosemary's Baby, that there, it's sort of an inverted conception of an immaculate conception of a different kind now than the kind we were talking about before, where there is a permeation of a spiritual being when the conceptive act of bringing sperm and egg together takes place, like the immaculate conception of the body of Jesus was actually done by Jehovah. It doesn't mean that the actual sperm came from Jehovah, but it just means that the very special case for producing that body was left in the hands of the highest of the angels, Jehovah. Okay, but that's way on. This is side trips time. We got to go because we're never going to get as far as we need to get. So then we were taken through various kinds of forms or potential forms, and we underwent a metamorphosis. And continually it was a matter of willing to be produced the spirit of living, and that produced an idea of a being that's willing to be, and out of that came a potential conception of a completed thought, and then that was reviewed going back through the realms this way. And so it was a cyclical kind of experience. Then comes something very, very important: rest. After this whole thing, which took a very long time, but I don't want to make the mistake of trying to put it in terms of years, because the way we see time now is different because we're in a different realm, totally different set of realms, and the conception of time must be altogether different. So you can't, you know, there are people that try to say, well, how many million years was this? Or, you know, you can't do that, because what you're measuring by, the experience that you're measuring by, is different. You know, like right now, we measure our time by the movements of planets and the changes of seasons and the changes of night and day and such like that. And we're measuring relative to the world that we live in. And our conception of time is accordingly. But in different realms, the conception of time is altogether different. Then there was a rest. And in this rest, there was a grand assimilation. It's sort of like a dog or a lion, better. A lion eats a meal and it lays down and sleeps for 2 or 3 days. It assimilates, takes its experience into it, and it remembers everything. And the memory is, oh boy, I'd love to get into that. What memory is a really interesting thing. But when you take the resiliency out of matter, out of the resistance of matter, that is memory. Memory is something where the form holds for a little bit. That's a very quick run by of it. But when you take the resiliency out of the matter that you congealed by your act of will in the first place, that's the other side of it. In the same way that for us, the interacting with matter produced will, from the divine's eye point of view, it was the will that solidified the matter. And when you take the will out, the memory is extracted from the matter itself, and the resiliency goes out, and the experience is taken back into the spirit. And there is a necessity to surrender. There's sort of like sort of like our muscles. They have to flex. They have to both tense and relax, and tense and relax. And that experience, to again re-experience the more chaotic absolute realms of the spirit, there must be a relaxation. And so the combination of taking out all the spirit experience and relaxing and buzzing over it with the new creativity, it's both a dreaming, a reflecting, a remembering, a pondering. If you've ever heard Wagner's operas, Erda, the earth spirit, unites with Mercury, and he goes down to the underworld. Wotan goes down to the underworld and wakes her up, and she says, "My sleep is dreaming, and my dreaming is the pondering of great wisdom." Beautiful, beautiful line. It's sung by a real deep voice, and it's sort of wavery. It's grand stuff. And okay, I guess that says enough. And then the whole thing cycles through again. However, we benefit from the past. Now things cycle through at a deeper level. We're now in the sun period, or the sun day, and the globes respectively they sink deeper. They run from the realm of life spirit all the way down to the desire world. And so this is the whole process. Through the Saturn, the Sun, the Moon, and the Earth period, everything becomes deeper and deeper immersed in matter. until the point where we get down to the physical plane in the Earth period. And then the whole thing turns around. In each great period of creation, there is, in the future, there will be more and more withdrawal. And it's always the Earth period, or it's always the Earth globe, that is the turning point. You can't go any deeper. So there is something, each of these has a quality. This, the Earth period, has a quality of finality. You know, like what we say about matter, even though we have a lot of illusions about it, we say, this is final. This proves it. This is limited. It's this and nothing more than this. That this chair is it. And that kind of formality and finality is what makes the turning point possible. Ooh, we have 10 minutes? Okay. Ooh.
It's 9 o'clock.
Oh, it is? You got a long way to go. Huh? Do you want to quit here? I can quit here and do double time next time. All right. We're going along really slowly, but I think rather than trying to accomplish everything that I want to accomplish, I think it's better to adjust to the feeling of the people. It feels to me like a better quitting time. Is it all right by you?
Double time, you mean you're
going to end on? No, I'm going to try and finish up the rest of the review next time, and then we're going to sink into the solar system as we know it now in the Earth period. And then we're going to talk about Polaris, Hyperborea, Lemuria, Atlantis, and things like that. And then we're going to talk about, you know, a lot about the current part of history.
No.
I'm going to go fast. I'm not going to be quite as slow about it. But although I don't mind it, I like the pacing of this. I feel very relaxed. I feel close with everybody here. It feels very good. Is that okay by you? All right. We'll adjourn for tonight.
Well, you caught my attention with alchemy, though. They may have had a lot more going on than meets the eye.
Oh, yeah.
Because I've done some reading, and, you know, they don't tell you the good stuff, where it's really, you know what I'm saying?
You've
got those good books, like those Paracelsus books.
Yeah.
Are supposed to be among the best.
Yeah.
And I don't find them easy to read. Do you?
No.
I have one woman who said she could understand it perfectly, and she's done a lot of stuff too. It's interesting.
All right. Can I get a hug?
Sure.
Nobody gets out the door without a hug.